Hey everyone, today we are diving into one of the most powerful tools in Unity that can change the way you structure your games. We are talking about scriptable objects. Now, if you've heard the term and feel intimidated, don't worry. In this video, we are diving into the basics, what scriptable objects are, how they differ from MonoBehaviours, and why they are so useful in managing game data. I'm also going to show you how to create one step by step and how you can use them to share data across scenes, which is super handy in larger projects. If you stick around until the end, I will also show you this neat trick that will help you do audio management in Unity with scriptable objects, which is pretty cool. All right, let's start with the big question. What are scriptable objects? Scriptable object is essentially a class in Unity. That's it. And we can create our own classes that inherit from scriptable object to create containers for data. Unlike MonoBehaviours, they don't need to be attached to game objects, and they persist outside your scene, so you can use them everywhere in your project. In simple terms, they're just assets that store data. They don't live in your scene like game objects do, but you can use them to hold information about things in your scene. You know, like player stats, inventory items, or even settings. For example, say you're making an RPG and you have a bunch of enemies with stats like health, mana, and strength. Instead of creating new variables for each enemy in your scripts, you can use scriptable objects to store that data for each enemy type. This keeps things neat because the data is centralized, reusable, which is the most important thing, and super easy to tweak. Okay, here's the most important difference. MonoBehaviours are attached to game objects in your scene, right? They manage behavior. Scriptable objects, they're data containers that exist outside the scene. They're assets. This makes them great for things that don't need to be tied to a specific object, like player stats or settings that you need to keep track of across multiple scenes. Imagine you have 50 different levels in your game. You don't want to recreate or reassign data every time, right? That's where scriptable objects save the day. Now, here's where it gets fun. Let's create a scriptable object to see this in action. And trust me, once you see how easy it is, you'll be hooked. We're going to create a player stats system. Say our player has health, mana, and experience points. We want to store this data somewhere without having to reset it every time we change a scene. This is where scriptable objects come in. Let's jump into Unity and write some code together. So we'll start by creating a new C# script and we'll call it player stats. But, and this is important, instead of inheriting from MonoBehaviour, we're going to have it inherit from scriptable object. This means start and update will not work. So let's get rid of it. We can now add the variables that we need to store in our stats. Make a note that they either need to be public or use the attribute serialize field. Easy, right? We got our basic stats here, health, mana, and experience. Now, to actually use the scriptable object, we add this little magic line at the top, and boom. This is an attribute that lets us create an asset with this class as the template, and we can pass in a file name and a menu name. So let's create one asset. Right click in the project panel, go to create player stats, which is our menu name. And now we've got a reusable asset that stores your player's stats. Let's call this player level 1. Keep a note of the naming convention. The 1 is separated. With this asset, we can now control the properties of a level 1 player character. Let's set the health to 100. Mana to 50, and experience to 100. The cool thing is, we can create another, or just duplicate this asset to create player level 2. And the naming convention helps. And for a level 2 player, we can set the health to 125, mana to 60, and experience to 150. You can see how well this thing works. This asset-based workflow makes it way easier to work with version control as well. Now you might be wondering, how do we actually use it in our other scripts? Good question. And this is how you do it. First, let's say you've got a player character in your scene. we're going to add a new script to the player called player controller to control their stats. Here's how you can link the scriptable object to this script. Inside this player controller script, we need to reference the scriptable object. We can write serialize field private player stats player stats. We can also make it public as well. The cool thing is that scriptable objects work just like regular variables in your script, and you can see it pop up in the Unity inspector for the player game object. We can now drag our player stats asset, the one we created earlier, right into this field. This way, the player controller script can access the data from the scriptable object. And just like that, we can use the player stats inside the script. For example, let's display the player's health in the console. So we say debug.log, playerstats.health. Now let's hit play and check the console, and it works. Now, via code, when the player levels up, we can swap out the level 1 scriptable object with our level 2 scriptable object, and there's no change in the way we code. If we update the health in the scriptable object, it will update everywhere the object is used. Super efficient, right? Now let's talk a bit about managing data. This is really important. Imagine you have 50 different levels for your player. Am I suggesting you create an array of player stats in the controller to manage them all? Absolutely not. Here's the thing. All of these are assets, right? That means we can use another asset to manage these assets. So managing data, whether it's player stats, enemy configurations, or audio, often involves creating an in-between scriptable object to handle everything neatly. But honestly, you only need to do this if your game is a complex RPG or you're working in a big team. For most cases, even if you're solo or in a small team, you'll want to manage these with dictionaries. Do not use arrays. Dictionaries are much faster, and you won't need to worry about array size or limits. We'll dive deeper into using dictionaries for managing data in part 2, which is our intermediate level video. So subscribe, hit the bell icon, and stay tuned. And while this method works well, it's not the absolute best way. My personal favorite is dynamically loading and unloading these assets. But that's beyond the scope of this tutorial. We'll touch on it briefly in the advanced video. But if you want a full deep dive into it, let me know. There's a lot to cover. Now, one of the biggest benefits of scriptable objects is the ability to share data across multiple scenes. Imagine the player's stats need to persist between different levels or scenes. Using regular scripts for that would be a hassle, because you'd have to pass the data back and forth. With scriptable objects, it's super simple. Because they exist outside of any particular scene, the data persists automatically. Let's say we move to a new scene. The player stats are still accessible, no problem. Here's how that looks in practice. We're in one scene, and the player's stats are set to health 150, mana 75. Now we move to another scene, and the stats are exactly the same. We didn't have to pass anything manually. Scriptable Objects handles it for you. But this is important to understand. Health and mana are values that constantly change. So we will not be storing these states frequently inside a scriptable object. But we can store the value inside another scriptable object at the end of a level. Let's say the health is now 50 and mana is 25. When we go to level 2, we can now read from this new scriptable object and get the updated player stats.
Let me show a very basic example so that you get the idea. Let's say you have 50 different player levels. In order to share this data across scenes without causing problems, we need a temporary scriptable object holder. We can create a new player stats and let's call it underscore temp stats. This is the temporary holder. On our controller, we can add a field for the temporary stats. At start, instead of setting the properties from the original scriptable object, we can do this. If this is the first time launching the game, and we can check that using a simple static boolean. If this is true, then we assign the original scriptable object's values to the temporary scriptable object. Note, we should only copy the values. If we copy the reference, This acts as a pointer to the original scriptable object, and it will still be destructive. And at the end, we are going to set that boolean back to false. All of this code will only run once after the game is launched. The remainder of the code will be run every time the controller exists, which means every level. And this means the temporary holder will contain some value. So we can set our local variables to our temporary object's values. Let's say we are in level 2. This code would have already happened in level 1. And because scriptable objects exists outside of scenes, tempstat will now have some value inside of it. And finally, in our function, before we load the next level, we can do things destructively by setting the properties of the original object. We don't want that. Instead, we can update the temporary object's values so that the other one is not lost or overridden even inside the editor. Okay? The point I'm trying to make here is, this is not a replacement for a saving system. Because in the build version of the game, as you can see right here, you can see that the data is shared to the next scene with scriptable objects. But if we restart the game, then the scriptable objects go back to their default value as set in the editor before building this game. Now, this is where it gets confusing, because this is not the case in the editor version, because Unity recognizes it and preserves the changes. So in a way, changing the values inside a scriptable objects in the editor is destructive. So you have to be careful. So in short, Unity tracks changes to scriptable objects and preserves them in the editor, but in the build version of the game, those changes get lost once we restart the game. Does that make sense? Essentially, they can be used to share data across scenes in the same session. Okay? If we were to close the game, we'd have to have a separate saving system to save the data. Okay? But just to make things clear, we can have one scriptable object with unchangeable data, like max health and max mana, and we can have a second scriptable object which stores the persistent data between scenes. Okay? Now you may be wondering, why not use don't destroy on load? Well, while that's a solid and easy option, scriptable objects offer some unique benefits, especially useful for larger projects. Firstly, they keep data separate from game objects, but more importantly, you have full flexibility. For example, instead of creating another player stats as a temporary holder, you can create a whole new scriptable object called player persistent data or something, and you can include any functions that help us do stuff whenever the level changes, and include other information like inventory data, quest progress, or unlocked abilities all in one container, which will also be useful to share between scenes. Alright, as promised, let's talk about audio management. Instead of just dragging and dropping audio clips into your scripts, we can create a more flexible system using scriptable objects for audio events. We've all been there, trying to find where a certain sound was set in our scripts. This method makes it easier to manage it. Imagine you have various sounds that play at different events. Like when an enemy appears, a player takes damage, or a special item is picked up. We can create an audio event scriptable object to encapsulate all the details for each sound event inherited from scriptable object. Let's make sure to add the create asset menu attribute, and let's give it a menu name audio/audio event. Let's have an audio clip, and to make things simple, add a volume and a pitch. Now what this means is that each audio clip can have a custom volume and a custom pitch, and it will be an asset. It's only loaded when we use them. We can now create a function called play, which takes in the game object's audio source, and we can change the pitch, set the volume, and play the clip. Here's how it looks. With this setup, each audio event is self-contained. You can create multiple audio event assets, like enemy spawn sound, player damage sound, or item pickup sound, each configured with different audio clips, volumes, and pitches. For example, you might create an enemy spawn sound asset like this. Now, whenever an enemy spawns in your game, instead of writing specific audio code in your enemy script, you simply call the play method of the enemy spawn sound scriptable object. This keeps your audio management neat and organized. If you want to change the enemy spawn sound later, you just update the enemy spawn sound scriptable object. No need to dive into your enemy scripts. The advantage here is reusability, as you can reuse the same asset for multiple enemies, and there's just a single line of code in your MonoBehaviour script. You can also use inheritance and virtual functions to add customization for each audio. In this example, I've created a random audio event which inherits from the audio event scriptable object. And this scriptable object plays a random clip from the array of clips. You can also add custom properties specific to this subclass, like min pitch and max pitch, just to add variety. Over on the audio event base class, I've made my play function as virtual. Virtual just means we can override this function in the child classes. So I have overridden the play function and assigned the base audio clip as one of the random array clips. And just to show you how powerful this thing can be, I've also created a custom function called ApplySettings in this child class, which randomizes the pitch for the variety. And I've called the play function inside the audio source. So you can see how powerful an audio event can simply be. And the cool thing is, in our custom scripts, we just need to have a reference of the audio event, and we can still assign a random audio event to that audio event because it is inherited. And finally, we can add a create asset menu attribute, which will allow us to create a separate random audio event which contains the base classes and the derived classes audio clips. So this is going to be really, really cool. And to a normal audio event field, we can now add our random audio event as well. So this is what makes this whole audio management thing very powerful. Also, I just want to point out that you can use audio mixer groups to achieve similar effects. But this allows customization for individual sounds compared to groups. But groups are easier to understand, so please do take a look at audio mixer. Let me know if you want a video on audio. And that's a wrap for this video. We've covered a lot, right? But trust me, this is the only foundational stuff that you need to know. In the next part, our intermediate level, we'll dive into some practical hands-on examples like using scriptable objects for AI, working with polymorphism, and even digging into dependency injection, which I think is a pretty cool concept. Plus, we'll cover scriptable objects as events and a lot more. I'm excited for what's coming next, and I hope you are too. So, I'll see you in the next video.